Greetings, friends and family of all saints. Welcome to worship. We are glad that you are joining us on this occasion. It happens to be Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost is that day of church celebration where we think of it as the birth date of the church. Also reminds us as God bestows his Holy Spirit, breathes life into his people of faith, and is a day of celebration for us in our life of faith. So again, welcome, and we are glad that you're joining us this day. I have a few things to share with you in terms of announcements. I want to extend an invitation for you to join us for our weekly Zoom meeting on Wednesday evenings. It is at 6:30 to 7:30. We're having some conversation amongst friends. Each week we will send out the address for it via Facebook and also via our blast. But we'd like you to join us. It gives us a chance for us to have some conversations and connect, and we hope you can be a part of those things. Wednesdays at 6:30. I also want to uplift our COVID team and our church council. They've been diligently meeting weekly, as you know. We're trying to give you little bits and pieces of updates. Next week, they are going to be coming into the church proper for the very first time in months. We're going to be surveying, walking through the building, kind of getting a better understanding of the layout, and we're trying to put forth some policies and recommendations for the congregation. So keep your leadership in your prayers. We know this is still a very tenuous and challenging time. Our church is not in any position to open up anytime soon, but we are moving in a direction towards that, or the hope of that. And so, as we say, be patient, trust in the Lord, and again, join us in these electronic services, and we know that we're able to meet you there. I also want to draw your attention, if you have not looked, to the bulletins that are posted electronically. We have a number of graduates, both in high school and in college, and we want to uplift those students as they are going on to new adventures, be it further education or perhaps trying to get out into the work world. We know it's, again, a hard year to close out, especially those graduates of 2020, but we uplift you in prayer. We think the world of you, we love you, and your names are going to be uplifted later during our prayers this day. And so please make note of those folks. A couple other things I just want to share with you, and I put it under the category, it's getting real. And folks, what I mean by that is this. We want to remember families as they are dealing still with the COVID crisis. It has touched our family here at All Saints. One of our members' grandmothers passed away of COVID-19 just this past week. And so when we often think about being out there and apart from us, that's the farthest thing from the truth. It has gotten real, as now it is, you know, touching people very close and near and dear to us. And so we remember those who have lost loved ones in this fight, those who are still fighting the good faith of fight, and we again continue to pray for our healthcare workers during this time. Lastly, today, I really want to just share a word of concern, and as well as a concern as people of God. We know that the past week has been plagued with some very sad news, especially out of Minneapolis, and dealing with George Floyd, the death that occurred. We know that the anxiety is running high on many, many levels. And if anything, as people of God, we need to stand up and be people of grace and love and justice and support, people of civility, people of non-anxious presence in the midst of a world that is in all kinds of turmoil. And so again, we pray for those families, especially the man who lost his life. We pray for those whose skin color may be different than our own. We pray for those people in law enforcement as they, too, each day are faced with very, very challenging situations. And we pray for the healing of our nation on so many levels. And so, again, our hearts go out to the situation that we've experienced over the past several days. And we pray for justice, but we pray for healing and peace. So with those words shared, let us now prepare our hearts and our minds for our worship before us this day. And we gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, ignite our hearts with joy and confidence, for God has done wondrous things for us. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us with the power of the rushing wind, that we may faithfully serve you in all that we do. For Christ has called each of us and blessed us. Come, Holy Spirit, be with us today. Help us to boldly proclaim Christ risen. And to that we say, Amen. Our gathering song, The Church is One Foundation. By sending into us your Holy Spirit. Direct us by the light of that Spirit that we may have a right judgment in all things and rejoice at all times in your peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading for this Pentecostal Sunday is Acts, the second chapter, beginning with the first verse. When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound, like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They're filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above the signs on earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Here ends our first lesson. Let us now join together in our gospel acclamation. Alleluia. Gospel, the Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter, beginning with the 19th verse. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, dear friends in Christ, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd like to begin with a true story today, and the true story has to deal with the sign that read, "The Marvelous Motionless Man." And the sign said, "Make him laugh, win $100. And so people were up to the challenge. Marvelous Motion Man, what does that mean? Well, I'm sure I can make somebody laugh. And so there was a big line. And the people lined up and they did all kinds of things. They told jokes, they tap danced, they made their face go into all kinds of different contortions. They did anything and everything imaginable, making fools of themselves, snickers from everybody around, except for the marvelous, motionless man. You know, sometimes people think that we're living in a time where there's motionlessness happening in our lives. Maybe we may even feel ourselves, we've become human couch potatoes, not sure what the next day will be. But this motionlessness is probably only a phase that we're going through. Well, this man by the name of Bill Fuca, the marvelous motionless man, stood perfectly still. And no one was able to make him laugh, make him smile. In fact, He is in the Guinness Book of World Records for doing nothing. Nothing. And you're probably thinking, I got a teenager at home that's maybe doing nothing, or maybe my spouse or significant other is doing nothing. Maybe they should be in the Guinness Book of World Records. Well, he's the guy. And it's said of him, he started this when he was back in middle school. In fact, he did it on a dare one time when he was out in a shopping mall. Decided to get up next to some mannequins and was motionless. He was able to reduce his pulse very low and his breath very low. And one of the patrons in the store walked up to him, looked at him, tweaked his cheek a little bit, and said, I thought it was a real person. Well, they mistook him, of course, for a mannequin of all things. But you know, actually doing nothing can be hard work sometimes, even for the marvelous, motionless man. But he attributes it to his focus, being razor sharp at times. And he may not laugh at people's antics, but he admits that he still has to breathe, and breathing is good. Breathing is really part of life, is it not? Well, when I read about Bill Fuca, the marvelous, motionless man, I thought about the church today. And there seems to be an assumption, a misconception, that our churches throughout the land, maybe in our community, even amongst some of you perhaps, in terms of where we're at All Saints, seem to be shuttered in some way and motionless during COVID-19. And that somehow we need to be ordered or directed to restart, to get things going, that we need to pray more. Well, here's a little message. A message to those who have that train of thinking or do not understand. You see, the church is never, ever about the building. It isn't. The church is about the people of God, acting and working in faith. It's about the people. It always has been. And we are essential. We always have been. I saw a cartoon the other day. First screen is Satan. Satan says, I shut down all the churches across the land. Next screen there, moving on, there's a picture of God. And God says to Satan, oh no, I've opened up churches now in everybody's home on every block everywhere. You see, it comes down to a matter of perspective. How are we seeing things? And how is God encouraging us to look at ministry in new ways? In fact, we're doing things in new and different ways that we never have done before. All by the power of the Holy Spirit and our Lord guiding us. And where did it all begin? Well, in the short run, perhaps when COVID-19 was announced, but in the long run, this reforming, this shaping, this renewal in our lives as people of faith has been happening all the way back at the second chapter of Acts. It goes back to that. It goes back to that day that we call Pentecost, 50 days after Easter. It goes back to that day when the Holy Spirit is bestowed upon the people of God. And they have flames of fire above them, the sound of a mighty rushing wind, the excitement that catches them all as they're gathered there in Jerusalem. And their hearts are filled with God's love, God's passion, God's joy, God's hope. And their faith is alive and it's well. Even after all the naysayers said it would end. And so the church continues. It does every day. And that spirit is not motionless in any way. And that spirit does not necessarily tie with the brick and mortar. Rather, it ties with the people. And Pentecost reminds us that gift is bestowed not upon the building, but upon the people of faith. And that Spirit is passionate, and that Spirit is alive, and that Spirit is there during the greatest of times and also the darkest of times. And Pentecost reminds us and tells the church to continue to be faithful, to walk in God's love. But it's never been about the building. And we have been in motion. And God continues to spur us on. You know, look at those disciples. Suddenly, without warning, like a rush of the wind, the Spirit is bestowed upon them, and their lives are changed by this presence of God and those fires that are lit around them. And look what happened to us with little or no warning, at least it seemed that way. All of a sudden, we had this time of virus and isolation. But you know, something is amazingly happening within the life of people of faith, and that God continues to inspire, and that God continues to direct, and that the church perhaps is enduring through a time of renewal that we've never seen before. And when we look back on this whole chain of events, we will be able to say with confidence, God's hand has been at work, reforming us, renewing us, inspiring us, giving us that fire and passion that's been needed for a long, long time. If you had said to me, Pastor Dean, you're going to be doing church differently in 2020, I probably would have laughed at you. But we've adapted quickly. And it might be the shot in the arm that we needed. And we need to look at the hopeful side, the positive side, the renewing side, rather than those anticipated losses or the grieving that may be weighing us down. I don't deny that that exists, but I want us to be able to look forward in faith and in hope with the guidance of God's love. The author of Acts, Luke, writes, "Suddenly, a sound came. It came from heaven like the rush of a mighty wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues of fire distributed amongst each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance." And it is clear that the gift of the Holy Spirit is the gift of faith that keeps us alive, and it is passionate, and it is active, and it is moving, and God's church is moving in unexpected ways. These past 3 months, we have been anything but motionless. We have not been closed. We're not like the marvelous motionless man. We have been essential all along. The book of Acts gives us a glimpse of what happened to those disciples on that first day of Pentecost. They went forth into an anxious world, and they were filled with faith, a faith that was active and alive, a faith that was reaching out to others with God's love. We often think about Pentecost as being the day that God breathed life into the church. Breath. Breath is always a sign of life. And if anything, God is breathing life, new life, into our churches that once were still, or stagnated, or stuck, or lost vision, lost hope. I truly believe that the Holy Spirit is present with us each and every way. You wait. Amazing things are happening. all around us, and the breath of God is within us. Breathing life. Life is important. Life is one that we hope is filled with fullness that God has enabled all people to be. In his book entitled Victory Over Death, Neil Anderson tells a story about a little girl who was born with a disability. And this disability was that she had weakened limbs, and at that time they decided to put braces on her, and she had a terrible time walking anywhere except with her braces. But this little girl was inspired by her brothers and sisters, and she asked her older brothers and sisters to help her walk, and she practiced day in, day out. And finally came the day when she went to the doctor's office for an appointment, and she took the braces off, and she walked across the room, and the doctor looked and smiled, and the parents were astounded, and together they said, "No more braces." Victory, right? Well, this little girl grew, and of course, always in the shadow of her older brothers and sisters. And she had a sister who was an outstanding basketball player and athlete, but her older sister really didn't want to play basketball, but this young girl, oh, she wanted to play so bad. And she went to the coach and said, "Coach, can I be on the team?" And the coach said, "I'll tell you what, if you can get your older sister to play, I'll let you be on the team." And so she got her older sister to be on the team. And always in the shadow of her older sister, there she was watching intently, riding the pine, waiting for her turn at some point. She had the oldest uniform imaginable, but yet she was on the team. And she went to the coach and she said, "Coach, would you spend a little extra time with me each practice, maybe an extra 10 minutes if you could?" And the coach first looked and said, "I don't think this is going to go anywhere." But then he saw a fire within her, and he understood her tenacity to be challenged and to overcome. And you know what? She became an outstanding basketball player. While she was in one of her games, there happened to be a referee that was there. The ref said, "You know, you really have some good footwork here. Have you ever thought about being in track? You seem to be able to run pretty fast." Of course, the young lady said, "No, I've never thought about being in track." He said, "You should try it." And so she did. She went out for track. And while she was out for track, some other people saw her, and they invited her to come to some Olympic trials. She was only 18 years old at the time, 18. And she ran the 100-meter dash and the 200-meter dash and the 400-meter relay in the 1968 Olympics in Rome as part of the team. And later that year, she was selected for the prestigious Sullivan Award as Outstanding Amateur Athlete in America. But it all began with that faithful move to walk and that simple trust of faith of God. And she attributed all of it to a conversation she had with her mother several years back. "Mom, I want to walk. I want to be like the rest of them." And her mother simply said, "Put it in God's hands. See where God will take you. You never know." And she did precisely that. Oh, her name? Her name is Wilma Rudolph. She began in braces, but she's an inspiration. Filled with a fire of faith and hope, the breath of life of Christ. Now, I can't stand before you today and simply tell you, you know, if you want to become a world Olympian or some major league player or athlete, all you got to do is have faith. I can't tell you that. But I can tell you this. Faith gets us many places in life. And just when we think that the door is closed, or the mountain is too high to climb, or the options are ceasing, that faith spurs us on, it inspires us, it encourages us, and that faith is contagious, contagious, and it's blessed by Christ. I truly believe that God will help us become all that God desires if we allow that breath and we take it into our lives. We are precious in His eyes. God sees the potential. God provides the life. But it's not going to happen if we make a career of doing nothing. It's not going to happen if we forget to exercise our spiritual muscles, so to speak, that we lose the discipline of praying, or we lose the discipline of some kind of worship weekly or however we feel necessary. It won't happen if we don't pick up the Bible and actually get into God's Word. It's not going to happen if we continually say no to God. Nope, don't have the time. Nope, don't want to do it. Nope, God, no. It's not going to happen then. We have to allow that room for the yes. But you know, Pentecost makes the challenges of the world a possibility. The coming of the Holy Spirit, the breathing of life into our very being as children of God. I am the church. You are the church. It's not about the building. It has never been that way. But it's about the people of God, inspired by the fire of faith. And to that, all I can say is amen and amen. We join in song as we speak of the Spirit of gentleness.
Thank you.
by the promised hope of healing and the resurrection, we join with people of God in all times and in all places, praying for the church and the world and all who are in need. We call upon your spirit of unity, Lord, giving thanks for our different vocations. Activate and utilize the diversity of gifts present in your church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we call upon your spirit of life, present in air and wind and humidity, in storms and oxygen and atmosphere, breathing energy into all things. We pray for healing with your breath of life, especially those who are dealing with very anxious times. Remember the families that have lost loved ones, those in our own church family, to COVID-19. We pray this day, Lord, for those in the Twin Cities and throughout our land, as there seems to be divisions and anxiety and fear and pain. We pray that as a people of faith, we may speak in love and guide in a peaceful and just way. We especially pray for those who are dealing with times of being lost and times of uncertainty. And we ask, O Lord, that your spirit would inspire and guide. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. On this day, we call upon your spirit of healing, Lord, to bless the nurses and doctors, the CNAs and the dietary staff, the housekeeping, those chaplains, counselors, hospice workers, all those who are taking care of those in need. We pray for those longing for comfort. And we ask, O Lord, that you would bring that. All these things we place before you, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we call upon your spirit of hope. You have led people through wildernesses. You have parted seas. You have calmed those with anxious hearts. And we pray, O Lord, that we may be united in faith and in love and in your spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. On this day, Lord, we also pray for those who are graduating in this year. We uplift the high school graduates, a part of our extended family here at All Saints. We remember Waylon Baumgart, Trenton Davis, Morgan Gary, Lucas Cleveland, Kira Melgren, Hudson Smith, and Carly Steinert. And we celebrate with those who have got advanced degrees, going to college or graduate school. We remember Erica Gary, Tyler Kajawa, Jordan Robble, and Kaylin Sitter. Lord, we pray that their lives may be filled, that new doors would be opened, new possibilities would be there, and we entrust them and celebrate them this day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. It is with bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we join together now in the words our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive this blessing. May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. And Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. Our closing time songs day is "O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." Again, I offer words of thanksgiving this day. We welcome Greg Path back. And Greg, thanks for playing for us today. Bethany, thank you again for sharing your vocal and musical talents. And of course, Ryan, without you, none of this would be possible on the technical side. Blessings, dear friends. Until we meet again, Christ be with you. May Christ keep you safe. And may that Spirit of God inspire you in ways that you can only dream of. God bless you this day.